two? What are you doing?
Making chocolate pudding.
It's 4 o'clock in the morning. Why on earth are you making chocolate pudding?
Because I've lost control of my life.
Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome back to Binging with Babish, where this week we're taking a look at Sad Sack Stewed Pickles 4 a.m. Chocolate Pudding, a stovetop version he was forced to make when he was unable to procure the requisite snack pack. Let's give this a little taste here for the sake of having a control group. Tastes like chocolate pudding. So let's move on. Now, you guys know that I am a stickler for accuracy. As such, any suitable recreation of this pudding must be made at 4 in the actual morning. Here we go, Andy. This is your job. This is the incredibly strange but beautiful career path with which you bring home the bacon. Let's shake off the cobwebs here. We are dealing with open flame. So we got ourselves a box of My Tea Fine Pudding, whose directions specify that it should be combined in a medium saucepan with 2 cups of cold milk. This makes sense because the primary thickener in American pudding is cornstarch, which clumps up if you add it to hot liquid. So we're stirring this over medium heat until it gets nice and thick and pudding-like. Then we're dumping it into our serving bowl of choice. I'm going with this one, covering with plastic wrap once it's cooled off a little bit and refrigerating for at least half an hour. I, however, could not keep my eyes open, so I decided to dig in before it was fully set, which is probably what happened in the Stew-Angelica standoff anyway. And I gotta say, it tastes just like warm chocolate pudding. And with that, I'm going to go get some sleep, then get dressed for work and explore how to make chocolate pudding from scratch. Into the same medium saucepan goes half a cup of sugar, 3 tablespoons cocoa powder, and 2 tablespoons of cornstarch. We're effectively making our own boxed pudding mix, but we're also going to add 2 egg yolks and 1/2 cup of heavy cream. Go ahead and whisk that together until it is nice and smooth. And then in comes 2.5 cups of whole milk in this recipe courtesy of America's Test Kitchen. Once this mixture is whisked to homogeny, we're going to place it over medium flame, continually whisking until it is steadily boiling. Basically, we're looking for even bubble coverage every time that we stop whisking. At this point, we're killing the heat and adding to the party 4 ounces of chopped dark chocolate, along with 5 tablespoons of unsalted butter. And then to amp up the chocolate flavor, we're adding 1/2 teaspoon of instant espresso powder, 1 teaspoon of vanilla extract, and 1/2 teaspoon of kosher salt. Whisking until everybody's gotten to know each other, the chocolate and butter are all melted, and we're left with some seriously delicious pudding, which we're going to strain just in case we missed any clumps of cornstarch or bits of coagulation. And then once strained, like all American pudding, it must be chilled in order to set. So we're going to pour it evenly into a goofy array of serving ware and let it cool off for about 20 minutes or until it's not steaming before wrapping in plastic wrap and chilling in the fridge for at least 4 hours, at which point we're gonna have some serious chocolate pudding. And since chocolate pudding in a martini glass just isn't chocolate pudding in a martini glass without a dollop of whipped cream, there that goes, and you will notice that this pudding has no skin. This could be a good or a bad thing, depending on who you are. Not entirely sure why that is, but I'm gonna chalk it up to the food gods over at ATK. Next up, we're taking one big step in a fancier direction and making pas de crème. Into a smaller saucepan goes 1 cup of heavy cream and 1/4 cup of whole milk, which we're going to heat over medium flame until just barely simmering, kill the heat, and add 4 ounces of chopped chocolate, along with 1/4 teaspoon each espresso powder and kosher salt. We are then whisking rigorously until everybody is melted and the mixture is smooth and creamy. Then back over on the prep table, we are separating 3 egg yolks from their whites and whisking said yolks together with 2 tablespoons of sugar. Once that's nice and smooth, while the chocolate mixture is still relatively hot, we're going to pour it in a slow, steady stream while whisking constantly. This is basically how you make a creme pâtissier. But instead of returning the mixture to the stovetop, we're going to put it in another French word that I'm about to butcher, a bain-marie, which is French for a Marie bath, I think. Basically, I'm nestling 4 ramekins into a kitchen towel set inside of a casserole, pouring our custard evenly into each ramekin, making sure that they're relatively level, and then surrounding them with boiling water. We want just about enough boiling water to come halfway up the sides of the ramekins, while the tea towel will hold them in place. Then we're covering the casserole with aluminium foil, or if you're lucky like me, putting a lid on top of the whole thing and placing it into a 325 degree Fahrenheit oven for anywhere from 25 to 35 minutes depending on the size of your pas. Then we are evacuating these pas out of their water bath and onto a wire rack, where we can examine their finished texture. They should be jiggly but set, gelatinous but solidified, wobbly but only probably. And we're letting these cool for 15 to 20 minutes because we want to eat them while they're still warm. And this is pudding 2.0. It's decadent pungent and rich and creamy and smooth and halfway between a pudding and a mousse, and a clear member of the clean ramekin club. But I know what you're thinking, what about what Australia calls chocolate pudding? It's a weird question, but the kind of question that I'm here to answer. Into a small bowl goes a third of a cup each brown sugar, granulated sugar, and cocoa powder. You can try valiantly to tiny whisk until homogenous, but you're better off using your fingies. And yes, I know you have a love-hate relationship with that word. Then over on the stovetop, in a 10-inch cast iron skillet, we are combining 2 ounces of chopped chocolate, 6 ounces of unsalted butter, and another third of a cup of cocoa powder. We're attempting to whisk this over medium heat, and at first wondering, what the hell am I doing with my life? But then, as time passes, realizing that it all comes together. And everyone's just trying to figure it out, just like me. Kill the heat, and then in a medium bowl, we are combining 2/3 of a cup of granulated sugar, 1 egg yolk, 1/3 of a cup of whole milk, 1 tablespoon of vanilla extract, and 1/2 teaspoon of kosher salt. Whisking to harmonious homogeny, and then bringing over to the stovetop, where we are going to slowly pour it into our still warm chocolate mixture while whisking constantly. Once that's pretty much all mixed together, we're gonna add 3/4 of a cup of self-rising flour, or the same amount of all-purpose flour sifted together with 2 teaspoons of baking powder. Once that resembles a chocolate cake batter, we're going to top it with our brown sugar mixture from before. Simply sprinkle that all over top, nice and evenly, and then we're going to do something crazy. Most recipes call for 1 cup of boiling water to be poured over top, but America's Test Kitchen has a great method of using 1 cup of freshly brewed coffee. And you guys know how I feel about adding a little bit of coffee to a whole lot of chocolate. And as you place this into a 325 degree Fahrenheit oven for 30 to 35 minutes, you might be asking, what the hell am I making here? And the answer, my friends, is self-saucing pudding. After letting it cool for about 15 minutes, we are scooping it out and serving it warm. As you can see, it's sort of like a layer of cake baked over an ooey-gooey core of chocolate sauce. And it is, excuse my language here, the bee's knees. Now, did this episode go completely off the rails? Yes. Did it produce 2 dishes that irrevocably changed my attitude towards and worldview of pudding? Also, yes.